Hello, BookTube. Welcome to my channel, or welcome back if you've been here before. My name is Beth Ann, and I finally have books in my apartment, which is very exciting. I realized that in my August wrap-up video that I posted last week, I actually forgot one book, and it was a book I really enjoyed, so I wanted to make sure I talk about it, and that is Orphans of the Tide by Struan Murray, and I read this following peer pressure by the wonderful Laura over at the Reading Mushroom, and I absolutely loved this book. It was so fun. It is a middle grade book, and it has strong vibes of the Golden Compass and the world in the Golden Compass, and specifically the world of Oxford as we're introduced to it in the beginning of that book, where we sort of have medieval town, very little technology, but what technology there is sort of like steampunky, so sort of an alternate reality of Oxford, England. And so in Orphans of the Tide, we have a world that has been destroyed by, in my brain, something analogous to climate change. But in the world of the book, it's presented as a conflict between the gods. And one of the gods, who is actually called the enemy, has flooded the world sort of some deep history. And this the characters in the book think is the only remaining city. And it is a city that is perched up on what used to be a mountaintop and is now just sort of a little outcrop in the ocean that has become the world. And then there are some outlying other mountaintops that are used for farming and hunting. But all of the action of the book takes place in this city, which is called the city. And our main character, whose name I am totally forgetting, is it Elsie or Elsa or something like that? Anyway, I haven't read this book in a few weeks, and I have it, but it's somewhere behind me or in this bookshelf here, and we have a lot less space in our new apartment than our old apartment, so you'll notice how messy the bookshelves look, and all of these bookshelves are two rows of books, and so I saw Orphans of the Tide as I was unpacking, and now I've totally lost track of where it is in these shelves, and we still have, oh gosh, something like 7 moving boxes full of books that just probably aren't going to get unpacked at all in this apartment. So that's my life. All my TBRs are out the window. I think most of the things that I was planning to read this year that I own actually are unpacked because I saw a lot of them as I was unpacking. But yeah, they're somewhere in this disaster. So who knows when I will be able to find them. Anyway, back to the book. I forget the main character's name, but that's okay. So Elsie or Elsa is, she's an orphan and she's about Lyra's age, like the Golden Compass. She's 8 or 10 or so. And she has a best friend named Anna. Anna works for the orphanage where she and the main character met, which is right across the street from where Elsie or Elsa now lives. And her mother, the main character's mother, was an inventor. That's where a little bit of the steampunk vibe comes in. So she would invent all these really cool machines. So she would invent like these little wind-up sort of like lobster-looking machines that people would send off sort of off the edge of the city onto the lower buildings that have been submerged by the flood. And it would collect all the shellfish and things that people eat. And so our main character is basically employed by the city for not very much money, but she's basically employed by the city to keep fixing her mother's inventions since her mother died several years before the action of the book. And then one thing that we learn sort of as the book progresses is that she had a younger brother, Finn, who she was incredibly close to. Of course, they were orphans together, etc. She, as the older sibling, had these very strong feelings that she needed to protect him and raise him. And her big trauma and the thing that's hanging over her is that she feels like she failed him and didn't protect him. And he is no longer, he died. He's no longer alive. And so that is a weight and a grief that the main character is carrying throughout the book. That is done really well because that is such a heavy feeling for a child to be carrying. And the whole book, the whole thing that moves the plot is sort of a metaphor for the weight of the things that you carry. And so what that metaphor is that the enemy, the god who drowned the world, makes periodic reappearances by selecting a host human, and then sort of feeding off of that host in a metaphysical way, you know, sort of like the emotions and mental energies of the host. And so the enemy starts out only being visible to the host, and the enemy often takes the form of someone that the host was close to. And so the enemy takes that form and grows stronger and stronger and stronger until eventually the host is sort of like an empty husk of a person, and the enemy sort of bursts out and starts to try to destroy the city and destroy humanity. And so in the beginning of the book, we have a couple events that convince everybody that the enemy is coming again, and it's been about 20 years since the enemy last emerged. So the main event that happens in the very first chapter of the book is that I think there's been a storm, and a dead whale washes up on top of one of the sort of roofs of houses that are partially submerged at the edge of the city. So a whale is sort of stuck on the roof. And a boy emerges from the whale. and our main character is, she's there because she's very curious about everything happening in the city. And she sort of realizes that something weird is going on with this whale. And then a hand emerges, and she helps this boy out of the whale. And then because, of course, everybody is very superstitious about this enemy thing, even though that's not really the way the enemy usually presents itself, most of the action in the book is driven because the people in the city, and in particular the Inquisition, whose sole purpose is to track down the enemy, are convinced that this boy is the enemy. And so there's like lots of chases from law enforcement and things because this girl knows that he's not the enemy and is determined to hide this boy and protect him because she didn't protect her little brother. And then the whole city is out to get them. And the best friend, Anna, is, at first she's very opposed to this. She also thinks that the boy is likely the enemy, but then as the action unfolds, she becomes convinced that that's not true. So there's sort of tension and conflict there where the main character, who knows what's right, and she is right, she knows that this boy isn't the enemy and is an innocent person, you know, they, there's that conflict and tension in that friendship, which is resolved at the end of the book. And there's a lot more I could say, but I won't because of spoilers, because it's middle grade. And so everything ends up pretty nicely wrapped up at the end. And then some of the big things that we learn about the enemy and what's really going on, and that we learn about the character and her grief for her brother, all of that is spoilery. So I can't say very much, but I absolutely loved it. I loved the world. I loved that vibe that reminded me of the Golden Compass, although being distinctly different. And then, you know, as an adult, I felt like I was getting real emotional things out of this book because it was dealing with such heavy stuff. The grief for a dead loved one, where you feel responsibility for the death. The tension with a friend when, you know, you're really convinced that you're doing the right thing, but it's a bit of a risk. And, you know, in some cases, like in this case, you sort of have to do the right thing, even if it's potentially damaging a relationship that you care a lot about, because this boy's life is on the line. So, yeah, so I thought it was very compelling. It's short. It's a quick read because it is for kids. And it was just wonderfully done and very fun and very creative. And I do have the second book called Shipwreck Island somewhere in here. And I'm excited to read that one because I think just based on the title that, our sort of little band of hero children are going to go exploring and are going to try to find, some of the other islands that, have also survived the flood. And they get a little bit more information about that in Orphans of the Tide. So that felt like at the end of the book, like a neat direction for the story to go, in a pretty obvious direction, but a neat one. So I do have that book somewhere, and whenever I find it, I will read that because I'm excited about that story and that world. So anyway, that was Orphans of the Tide. I did read it in August. Wanted to make sure I covered it before I think about moving on to my September reads. So I hope you're all having a good month reading. Let me know if you're interested in this book down below. I think it's really cool. And I will link to Laura's videos over at the Reading Mushroom where she talked about these books. So if you want to see somebody else who also really appreciated the books, you can go watch those. All right. I will see you on the next video. Thanks for watching. Bye.